Bratati Banerjee. She is Professor, Department of Community Medicine, Maulana Azad Medical College, Delhi. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. And now I hand over the mic to the chairpersons for conducting this session.
First of all, good morning to one and all. Please say good morning and we warm up. We are all pediatrics at our mind, and we are discussing now about geriatric care. And I'm so thankful here Dr. Indra Prakash is there, a very, very important key person from the ministry. And thank you for supporting this endeavor, Dr. Prakash. Sir, you have been really very supportive. And before, you know, we have assembled over here, the idea of this session was that we had conducted a workshop with the help of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and WHO at Maulana Azad Medical College, that how, you know, what are the needs of elderly, how our key functionaries are going to take this whole initiative forward, because you will see that geriatrics is not a very small this thing. It has got the whole range, and the total population, you know, over a period of time has increased tremendously and will be increasing. So with this background, I'll not take much of time. I'll tell the speakers to stick to 15 minutes, and so that we can have 15 minutes for discussion. So first I'll invite Dr. Indra Prakash and Dr. Indra Prakash has done, after 1984, after MBBS, he joined in the PHC as a medical officer in 1984. So that's his very, very great background. He has been assistant director of public health at Chingalpet. Again, a very wide distinct. Then again, he has worked for National Program for Leprosy at the National Headquarters, Delhi, National Program of HIV/AIDS, Vaccine Manufacturing Institute. And then also, you know, he has been a public health specialist in the national programs in the Ministry of Health. He has got over 15 publications, and he is contributing a lot to the national and international conferences. So let's give a big hand to Dr. Indra Prakash. And I'm telling you, the whole workshop which we had of WHO was successful because of his key inputs. The person who works at the program level knows the nitty-gritty of, you know, different partners who are involved in that. So with this, maybe have Dr. Indra Prakash, please. Thank you so much.
Day two.
The next one, Pankaja ka inko de do beta, and then up third wala kan. Aise kar raha. She's having this thing, Harish.
Good morning, Madam Garg, my friends, teams from the different institutions. Before starting the discussion, I will just thanks to the organizer of this conference for giving me an opportunity to discuss the concept of geriatric population. This way, the geriatric is a coming up branch and expanding very, very rapidly. The issues and concerns of the elderly are wildly different than the conventional medicines which is we are practicing day-to-day life. So just to have the look, let us see what is there in the geriatric population. This will be the presentation, so there will be only five or six sets of slides. To start with the background, what is the geriatric? This is the definition. The National Policy for Older Persons, 1919, which has been decided, any person who has attained the age of 60 is called an elderly person. So further, after 60, there is plenty of years to be lived. So they say there are young old, older olds, and oldest old, depending upon the age, 60, 70, and 80. And 80% has the privilege, and these are the people who are creating a problem, and this is the segment which is increasing very, very, very rapidly. This is the demography. Specifically, this is India. Indian citizens, not any other things over there. The total population, it is what is current status and what is the projections. If you look at the 1915, long back, 50 years back, The total population of the country was 36 crores and projected, I mean, 2011 census, it is 121 crores. And projected for 2050 is 165. This is how the population, general population, total population increasing. But if you look at the older population, there was only 2 crores in 1950, 10 crores today, that is 2011 census, and projected is 32 crores 2050. If you look at the proportion, it was 5, now it currently at 8, and it is projected 20. Now this is seems to be a very small proportion, but when you translate into numbers, it goes a very huge number. This is the number, and then there are certain indicators, that is the sex ratio. The males will outlive the females will outlive the males in the geriatric group. Overall, population ratio is less, females are less. But when you come specifically for the older population, the females overshoots. Life expense is quite high. 67 is the current, and it is expected 75. By 50, fertility rate is declining. Aging index, this is an aging index, is one of the important indicators, which is a ratio of the older versus younger people, that is the children. And you see, it is increasing from 27 current to 105. That means there will be more older people, less younger people. Median age is one of the indicators when it goes, the longevity of the life is also, and it is also increasing. The consequences indicator which are there, the old age dependency ratio is increasing. That means there will be more number who will depend on the earning members of the society. The potential support ratio is declining. That means those people who has to earn, they will decline. Current 1950, there were 17 people to earn and one people to eat. 11, there will be 14 people. And by 2050, it is projected there will be 4 earning members to feed the one person. So this is the way how the things will happen in future, so which is visualized. Looking at the different segments, while we see the population is growing at the rate of 2% total population, what the elderly population, specifically the 80 plus population, is increasing at the rate of 3.8%. That is a very, very rapid growth of the oldest. Median age currently is 26, but the youngest nation in the world, which has the median age 15, is the Yemen. And the longest, the oldest is the Japan, where the median age is 41. 41, if we take the median age, that means that life expectancy will be double to this. That means nearly 82 years is the lifespan in the Japan. Older women will live higher, 2 to 5 times higher the age. And then the health of the older person deteriorate with increasing age. That is the problem. Increasing age is not a problem. Increasing number is not a problem. The problem is, as the age increase, the health deteriorate of the person if they are not taken care of. And that is the concern. I will show you how it will be. So here, the decline in fertility and reinforced by the increasing longevity is the major determinants for the increasing number of the older persons. The difference is that in developed country, it took 100 years to reach 14% of the elderly population from 17. That means from 7% to 14% to become the segment of older person, it took 100 years. And during this period, 100 years, they diversify their system, they develop their system, and they developed everything what is required for the old age to health. But if you look at the trends in the developing country, it is entirely different. Today we are at 8%, and if we have to reach 14% by 2050, we are expecting 20%. What is the time left with us? Today we are at 20. 2050, we are expecting 20% of the total population will be elderly. We are left with only 30 years. So within 30 years, we have to handle 20% of this segment, which is a very difficult job. So what is the way forward? The way forward is that the profound, pervasive, and ending consequences of the older population, there is no time left, and we have to work on barefooting to do everything what is required for the older persons. This is the main message from where we have to proceed. And if we don't do, see, then what will happen? You just look into that. If we don't do anything at this, morbidity profile. You see, these are the statistics which is available in the literature. Perhaps we have, in India, we have a very less number of amount of literature, and these type of information aren't available. The literature says 75% of the older person, they suffer from one or the other disease, and that too of chronic nature. This is a very, very bad thing. If 75% of people are suffering from one or the other chronic disease, then what will happen? They say 53% they have one chronic disease, 20% they have two chronic diseases, 3% they have more than three chronic diseases. So as the age increases, the number of diseases also goes on increasing. The second problem is the disability. 40% of the older people, they suffer from one or the other disability. And the disabilities are all which can be taken care of. The third parameter is the psychiatric morbidity. And they say 25% of the older people, they have one or the other psychiatric problem. The institution is the worst problem. The people, the concept of the Western world or the developed world where they say they have well-developed old age home, but the problem with the institutional elders is that 65% they have one or the other psychiatric problem, and that is a very, very killing statistics. So with this background, added to this medical morbidity, there are the social variables. You see the number of things, the abuse, the widowed, the holding of property, and dependency, no income, living children, not living with children. Many of the social issues are there which we they silently suffer from that. Added to this, as we have said, the females outlives, the problems of the females with the aging, they goes on aging. Overall ratio is 940, at 60 is 1,022, at 70 is 1,590, and at 80 is almost double, 2,000 per 1,000 males. This is the type of statistics which are available for the older females. The major concerns are the destitute, social insecurity, financial insecurity, medical problem, and emotional insecurity, and added to this, the human right of the older people and many other things. So thus, the focus should be shifted from the older woman on the older women, since they have specific needs and they need to special attention. So where we stand with this type of statistics, the aging population will have to more chronic diseases. They are associated with the disability. If urgent action is not taken, the anticipation is that we will have a sick, disease-ridden older society. That is a very, very difficult statement to make it, but this is the reality. And it will be added or burdened by the socioeconomic consequences. Thus, there is an urgent need for healthy aging initiative today so that the elder segment of the population does not suffer these type of consequences. To do what the globally the people are doing and what the people in India we are doing, let us see what is there. This is the global response. 1982 is the beginning of the healthcare of the elderly, when the Vienna International Plan of Action was on aging was developed, which is popularly known as VIPA. Then in 1990, second landmark is the International Day for Older Person. 91 came the principles of older person, or the rights of the older persons. 99 declared by the International Year for Older Persons, which is the very popular landmark from where everything shootouts. And this is the year when the India also developed the nation policy for older person. 2002, that is the Madrid International Plan of Action. This is the landmark document on which all the current strategies for helping the older patients are being worked out. And very recently, 2015, the World Report on Healthy Aging, they have gone step forward. That is, prepare yourself for the welfare of the older people. and then have a decade of elderly from 20 to 30. So we are just sitting at the start of the decade of elderly, and what we have to do during the leftover period, I will just explain to you. These are the healthy aging practices. If we just take care of all these few things, that the nutrition, physical activity, injury prevention, substance abuse prevention, medication, vaccination, home-based and healthy aging, more than 60% of the problem of the elderly will be sorted out. This is the way how we can help. That is making a commitment. The commitment of India has already made. We have a national program for healthcare for elderly. That is the biggest commitment. Along with that, all the medical institutions and the regional geriatric center and the national center for aging are coming up. The second is the most vital. That is the age-friendly environmental. Perhaps we have to do something with the Ministry of Urban Development. The third one is the alignment with the health system, which we are doing. That is the prerogative of the Ministry of Health. The third one, fourth one is the development of the long-term care. So madam will discuss with you over here on this aspect, but this is a area which is lagging behind. And the fourth one is the making measurement, how far we have achieved and where we are going. So the consequences were very grave. So the attention was drawn quite long, more than 50 years back, but the shortcomings still are there, which are something like unmet needs, and we have to do urgently for this. Developing country has to work two times, three times, and sometimes four times to do this work to take care of the older population. India's response is very, very specific, and it's coming up in a big way. We have provision for the older people. There is a constitutional provision under Article 41 and 47. There is a legislative provisions under the National Policy for Older Person, National Council, then Interministerial Council. Then there is a Maintenance of Senior Citizen Welfare Act, which is a very, very popularly being widely circulated with the penal interest. These are the safeguards for the older persons. And this is the National Policy for Older Persons, which works for the welfare of the older person. Only 14 ministries are involved, and the key nodal ministry is the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. Quite a large time has been passed and the program is in place, but the evaluation says the provisions are there, but I am coming to that. So plenty of things are yet to be done. So as a part of the National Policy for Old Person, we have a national program of health care of elderly with this very clear objective that to provide accessible, affordable and high quality long-term competitive dedicated care services for the olding elderly people. These are the program components. We have an NHM component under which we provide the services at the sub-center, primary health center, community health center, and district health center. There is a tertiary component. Dr. Harish is over here. He will discuss with many more. There are regional geriatric center and there are national center for aging. And the third component is the central component, which is concentrated on the research component, and a very big research project is going on, which is called the LASI, and shortly the information will be available, which they have developed or generated. This is the outcome we expected by the 12th plan. By the end of 12th plan, we will have we will roll out the program all over the country, but it could not be happen. About the revised target is that we should be rolling out by the end of 2020, all the districts of the country will be covered, they will be operational. Package of services at the district level, there are OPD services, there are indoor admissions, physiotherapy, laboratory, screening of the people, domiciliary visits, assistive devices, referral and IC. These are the things which are at the district and sub-district level. And at the tertiary care, there are OPD, indoor, human resources development, MD geriatric medicine, and research geriatric. More things will be discussed on this aspect by Dr. Harish. This is the package of services under the program. This is the support, financial support, which is given. So for a regional geriatric center, 533 crores, district hospital, 131 lakhs, and similarly at CSE and PSC. This is the human resources which is given. 38% are provided at the RGC level, 13% are additional person on contract basis up at the district hospital, 1% at the CSE level. This is the progress. Currently, total districts which is provided to us information is 715 and 599 districts. And Dr. Gauri has taken care of to consider all the leftover districts this year, this BIP is process is over, and all these 715 are recommended to implement the national program of healthcare available. Last till March 2018, 250 districts were operational to our information. But during the review meeting, what we have read, it is not the 250, it's more than 500 districts which have started giving services, and this state, Himachal Pradesh, has already, all the districts are sanctioned, all the districts are providing services, at least one OPD are indoor. This is the status of the regional geriatric, total 20, 16 are providing services, that is the information, the rest of the things will be discussed by my friend. This is the type of services. The number of OPD and indoor admissions are increasing from 15 onward. So mean the more and more institutions have started operational, and therefore more and more people are seeking the services under this program. Similarly, the RGCs, they have also started from 8, and now there are 20, 16 are present. There are also number of the services is on increasing order. That means more and more people are seeking the services of the tertiary care system. So this is the most important. I will just take 2 to 3 months. This is the total 21 services which has to be provided under the program by one or the other ministry. 19 services has been established. That is 42% of the system is ready, and remaining system, that is 52%, is yet to be made ready. The problem is that most of the leftover area, that is developing the system for long-term care and developing the system for age-friendly environment, is with the other ministries. So Ministry of Social Justice, Ministry of Urban Development, and we have no control over them. We have to request them. We have to collaborate with them. So there is no progress in this area. Rest, everywhere this work has been started, but we have to work still to get the all the components operationalized. Six activities has been completed, 9 activities work is initiated, so but still in progress, and there are 6 elements where the no work has been started. That is the total information as on date out of 21 activities. So the work has been started, but the focus and priority to the aging population is lacking. So everybody say we will do, but there is no priority and there is no interest in that. That is the fact of the on the ground. So currently the system is not ready to combat the challenge. If we have to say that everything is being provided, no, at this stage not only the healthcare, health is being provided to certain extent. So what we have to do, we have to adapt the strategy of Daljo, which is has two components. One is the preparedness up to 2020, and then decades of ready, that is 21 to 30. That is the two strategies which are coming up, and everybody who is whoever is concerned of the elderly, they are working on this this line. So next step is we have to give the priority to 10 areas. This is the area which has been listed in number one, and then we have to monitor through the 10 indicators that these things are in operation. These are the area which has been identified. These are the indicators which have been identified to see that the things are in position, and then we have to do. There are certain things which central government has to do. There is certain things which the state government has to do. So central government has to sanction the district, sub-district, develop the training material, develop the IC material, develop the IT system to monitor the things. And the state has to establish the infrastructure, operationalize the service delivery, and establish the web-based MIS. These are the two things. Specific for the state government is to all the districts are sanctioned, they have to make it operational so that they have to ensure that the services are provided to the older people. And then come the second stage, which is called the decade of elderly. Here, we will be providing primary and secondary care at the district and sub-district level. And during this, at these facility, the physical and mental capacities are to be built. Geriatric syndrome is to be taken care of. And the caregiver support is when that is both formal and informal work health force has to be developed. And then tertiary care through RGCs and NCA has to be developed for reference. Finally, the strategy which had an advantage is sometimes called the primary health care strategy. Similarly, in for elderly, this is the ICOP, integrated care of the older person. The strategy is very clear. You identify an older person who has problem, examine, make a diagnosis. Without diagnosis, you don't do anything. Then once you make a diagnosis, he may be suffering from one, two, or three diseases. You plan which is the line of action which is to be provided and finally implemented. These are three pronged strategy which I have to teach. So with this, the main message of this presentation is that the population aging is will continue, and so the consequences. If we don't do the consequences will be more, population will be more. If we are sluggish, it will lead to a disaster. Or if we are concerned, it can become an opportunity. And now it is your choice to decide you want to take an opportunity or you just want to keep, when the problem will come, we will see, and then what will happen, nobody will be responsible for that. We will be responsible for that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Inderjeet, for a very, very wonderful and elusive presentation. And it is always, I say, that it is so important to listen from the government and government of India's perspective as to what is their mission, what is their vision. And you can understand the journey of slides which it took from what is the definition of elderly to where we are now, what are the strategies which are planned, and particularly we have got only 25 to 30 years left, not like other countries which had 100 years. So it is so very important. We'll take the question answers in the end, but please give him a big hand. Thank you, sir. Thank you for.
Now may I invite Dr. Pankaja Raga, the next speaker. She is professor and head in the Department of Community Medicine and Family Medicine at AIIMS Jodhpur. Madam is Vice President of Indian Public Health Association. She is fellow of IPHA and FEMR fellow. She has 40 papers in national and international journals to his credit.
Really, ma'am.
And she's principal investigator of many projects. Madam, please.
From sir's presentation, it is very clear that we have growing number of elderly people all over the world, and especially India. And considering this fact, even sustainable development goals and WHO report also caters to this particular age group of population. So topic for me is long-term geriatric care, Indian perspective. As sir also has mentioned, it's really in neonatal stage. We are talking about it, but definitely it is not implemented in our country. So all the developing countries, they do have long-term geriatric care, and there is a WHO report on best practices by different countries. We can learn from those countries and we can develop a model for our nation. As far as definition of elderly population is considered, developed nation, they consider 65 and above as the definition for elderly. But as United Nations also says, and India, we say 60 and above as the elderly population, and our figure is definitely increasing. And as far as 2017 report for WHO is considered, considering the definition of 60 and above, we have 962 million population, that is 12% of total population as the elderly population globally. And projected figure for 2050 is 80% of older people will be living in low and middle developing countries. As far as India is considered, we can see the growing number very clearly. Presently, we have more than 8% as far as last census is considered. But if we look at the projected figure of 2050, it will be around 19% of our population will be elderly population. Why we are talking about geriatric care is essential, because there are several reasons for it. As we know, repeatedly we are saying it's rising population. Then there are other several reasons like decrease in physical activity, and that leads to many other morbidity and even mortality. Then economic inadequacy, increased vulnerability to different diseases, and we will come to that figure that chronic diseases are more common, and that is where disability will be more common in this particular population. And different approach and management is required for this age group. And as we know, because of competitive life and people are migrating to different places, this old population, they are left alone at home. That is also important factor we have to look after. So there are several challenges. Bigger challenge is the social challenge. In the current scenario, we know that population, the younger group of population, they are migrating, and nowadays it's nuclear families, and then this dependent population, the older population, they are left home. So if we look after their health, maybe they will be utilized as the advantageous group and not the dependent group. This is the nationwide survey carried out by Agewell Foundation, and the report is, this is from the rural and urban area, what is happening to this population. So we can see most of them are living with spouse, only spouse, not other family members. Few of them are living alone, and some of them are living with family members. And maybe few other, very less number of people, they are living with maybe friends or some other relatives. Almost same is the picture for rural and urban group of people. So we can see here epidemiological transition of the disease. Very clearly that dark blue depicts the non-communicable diseases, and the consequences of non-communicable diseases will be disability and handicap. So all across the countries, this figure is increasing. Then major problem is mental health, various mental health problems. Including dementia and mood disorders are common in this particular age group. This is the report from Alzheimer's Disease International World Alzheimer's Report 2010, and we can see the costing for dementia is $600 billion in 2010. And this is including family care, community care, and as well as professional care. These are some figures from our countries. Acute morbidities, we can see the percentage, around 30% in this particular age group. And as far as males and females are considered, it is almost same. These are common morbidities. Cataract is the highest. So non-communicable diseases are commonly seen in elderly population. This is the small study carried out in Tamil Nadu, rural population of Tamil Nadu in 2006. There is less literature on this particular area. As we know from different studies that sedentary lifestyle and decreased physical activity leads to different morbidities, and later on complications, mortality, and disability. This is the systematic review where the global picture is the elder population is sedentary. Elder abuse is also a rising problem. One in six people across the globe they are suffering from this problem. And we can see 15.7% globally. And we are also not lagging. Our figures are very high. So 52% they reported mistreatment and harassment in India. More than 50%. And these are different ways of elderly population is being mistreated, neglect, domestic violence, harassment, abandonment, and other types of crime. Very high figure. In the same study, these elderly population, they were asked about safety and security services. Their awareness was checked, and we can see very few people, they are aware about all these services. Healthcare services, financial support, legal support, very poor figure, family support. So there are several initiatives by our government, including national policy on older person. Then we have national program also. So many things are being launched in our country. Few years back, around 10 years back, I have carried out one ICMR project on elderly population. That time, the figures about awareness and utilization of healthcare services was very, very poor. Now the realization is happening, and government initiatives are also encouraged. So considering all these burdens and looking at the best practices of other countries, especially developed nations, there is definitely need for long-term care. So what is it exactly? So it involves variety of services. Sometimes these elderly population, they suffer from chronic illnesses. Maybe they are being operated. So for a brief period of time, they might require care, healthcare. But sometimes this gets extended, and that is why long-term care is required by these people. This care can be provided majority of the time by the family members, and they are the immediate caregiver. But the challenge is most of the time they are not available. And who actually provides care at home? It is usually the female person. But nowadays, because females are also employed, so they are also not available at home. So that becomes a challenge. So these long-term care can be facility-based, they can be home-based, or they can be like in home-based, like self-care also is part of home-based care. So the services can be like family caregiving, home health care, or even for their daily activity, we can help them. So that is also part of home care. And nowadays, technology is expanding. So various technologies can be utilized for providing services. This question was also asked to this particular group of people. And 38% they said yes. This is required, palliative care and long-term care. That means they are aware about this requirement. And what forms it should be provided, that also is encouraging. A report is being there. You can see traditional, like family support, they expect 52% of them, they expect that it should be provided by family members. Healthcare, 14%. Self-care becomes important because, as you have seen, most of the time care given by family members becomes challenging. So if we train our elderly population, so maybe they will be independent, and it will become easy for all of us because they themselves are involved. So in this direction, work has been already started, and the modules are developed for training this elderly population and even their caregivers. It has several components. I won't go into the details. That includes personal hygiene, then skin care. Even they are being trained for bed sores, prevention of bed sores, even care for the bed sores. Then self-care through healthy lifestyles, and even they are made aware about availability of vaccines and medical care for this particular age group. So these are again components of that module. So exercises are being taught, breathing exercises especially. So there are several aspects in the module. So these elderly population themselves, they are made aware about several different aspects so that their life becomes easy and they are not vulnerable to meet with the accidents or other harms. They are also made aware about the psychological needs, even their caregivers, because we have seen that abuse, elder abuse figure was really very high. In this particular training module, various components are there. What actions are to be required and what is the usefulness, so that they are motivated to get trained themselves and even the caregivers are trained. Diet is also an important component for this age group. So they are sensitized about dietary management. So that was self-care. So self-care is one of the component of home-based. But when home-based care is given by somebody else, maybe by the family member, so most of the time it is unpaid or it can be paid by somebody else, maybe the nursing person or any other person from outside. So that is also included in home-based care. So family members, nurses, and other paramedical workers, they are being trained in this direction. So module regarding this is also ready so that these people are trained for providing elderly care. So these are different components. So they are sensitized for various diseases in elderly population. Role of healthcare is also being mentioned. Role of family member when they suffer from these diseases. All the common diseases are included in the module. Most of the time, health professionals, doctors, we prescribe something, and elderly population or any other person, they don't know how to use it. So they are required to train how to use different things. Maybe they are diabetic, they are on insulin. So how insulin is being given or how the puff is being used. Thank you, sir. It's over. This is the last slide.
Very nice for a appropriately finishing time.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for your nice presentation. To sum up what I have learned, that we should learn from the Western country about the technology part and how, regarding the infrastructure part or the other things which they have better than us. But simultaneously, I want to emphasize and I want to add to this thing. The crux is that the poor status of geriatrics is because of diluting moral values and diluting family values in our culture. In this regard, I feel that up to certain extent, we people are responsible. Whenever we meet some youngster, we ask what you are doing and what is your package. we evaluate the youngsters from their package or their earning potential. And if somebody is not up that much up to our expectation, we say, leh, fulane da kaka te enna kamanda hai, tu aje piche hai. We never ask that what are your moral values, he or she may be taking care of the other parts also. So if, because sir has told that we are left with only 20, 30 years. So those who are young now, they will be in the middle age at that time, and we people will be in the geriatric age at that time. If we really want to improve the situations over a period of time, there is a need to change the mindset of our generation also, so that we can inculcate good habits in the youngsters. Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
So now we come to the third presentation, the last for this session. I invite Dr. Harish Agarwal for this last session. Dr. Harish is faculty at Regional Geriatric Center of Dr. SM Medical College, Jodhpur, and he is part of many WHO studies, and he is also associate editor of Journal of Indian Academy of Geriatrics, and he has published many papers in geriatrics and medicine. So we invite Dr. Harish for his presentation.
Good morning, Chairperson.
Good morning.
Good morning, my dear students and colleagues. Thanks to NPSC for inviting me to share the experience of RGC, Regional Geriatric Center of Jodhpur, with all of you. Regional Geriatric Center is a tertiary level care center under the program of NPSCE. And when in 2010, the 8 RGCs were sanctioned, Jodhpur was one of them. It is our RGC Jodhpur. The RGC, as being the tertiary care level, has been given the responsibility to provide tertiary level care services for complicated serious geriatric cases, developing the postgraduate course, developing and updating training modules and guidelines for and IEC material, training the manpower, developing evidence-based treatment protocols for geriatric disease prevalent in the country, research on specific diseases which are common in elderly population, and awareness about disease and needs of the elderly patients among general populations, health professionals, as well as doctors and policymakers. This is the building of Regional Geriatric Center, Jodhpur. This is the OPD registration counter. This building is having one floor dedicated to Regional Geriatric Center. The patient has to come to this place, he registered here, he has been consulted and given the advice, the laboratory tests are being done at the same place, and the drug dispensing is also done at the same place. The one point services at RGC. Indoor services are also here. Here is a 30-bedded hospital, where the 5 beds are reserved for the acute care and remaining are for the normal patients. RGC is doing regular programs for community awareness. These are the few pictures about community awareness programs among the elderly population. Training of medical officers, almost 35 training modules of doctors has been completed in RGC, Jodhpur. Nursing training programs, physiotherapist training programs. There is a specialty clinic at Geriatric Center where one of specialty person comes at pre-scheduled time and see only the elderly persons like cardiologist, nephrologist and among urologist, etc. Free drug distribution center. Rajasthan is a state where the drugs are free to the patients, and this center is at Geriatric Center. So patient doesn't have to go anywhere else for all these services. There is one physiotherapist center. One small daycare center is running at this place. It's a good program, that is a talk with expert program. Here we don't teach the patient, treat the patient, but we clarify their queries about some disease. There are few photographs like orthopedician, one is the nephrologist. They are here to discuss the issues like what is dialysis, what happens with renal failure, what is the diet, And it's a common talk with expert program. It's not one-to-one patient care program. Again, few other specialists. He's the psychologist. One is the urologist. Meditation and yoga activities are continuously being run among the students as well as elderly population. One paper has been published on role of yoga and meditation in elderly population. With the help of social welfare and departments, we are distributing the helping aids, like common helping aids, which are available through that. We don't have budget for this, but we organize things from them. Community-based eye checkups, audiometry testings. Again, awareness program in Jodhpur. Visit of the public health student at Geriatric Center to make them aware about the elderly population and the activities of this center. Visit of AIMS Jodhpur students. Pankaja ma'am regularly sends patients, students to us. Celebration of different health days. Diabetes Day, No Tobacco Days, Elderly Days. Few general activities, plantation and other. Research programs, as sir told, was the component of the tertiary center as the RGC. We are presently doing 11 research projects. 4 has been completed, 2 has been published, remaining are under process. These are the sanctioned by the ethical committee. Then we sponsor it and we do the project. Pankaja ma'am has taken a class for the long-term care in the elderly population. We are trying to develop a new trial where we started to train the attendants of the patient about few common things which they need when the patient is discharged from the hospital. Like, we thought that what can be the cost-effective medical long-term care is doctors cannot be, nurses cannot be. Most common and most affectionate will be the family members. And it will also increase the increase the family values in the society. But they have their own limitations. They are having lack of knowledge, lack of handling of routine devices like catheters, rice tubes, BP instruments. They don't have skills. And unaware about the common medical complications. If we train these family members, like spouse of the person, son-in-law, son, daughter-in-law, daughter, they are benefited economically, round-the-clock care at any time, and better emotional attachments, social respect also. As Mahajan sir told, now the family values are decreasing. But if somebody cares, his social value is increased. Integrity of the family ethics. So this is the caregiving training program at RGC Jodhpur. It's a startup and we have completed only the 2-3 years and we are training, done 30-40 trainings. The component of this training program is communication skills. It's a 2-3 hours training program. Nutrition assessment and diet planning in the natural local available foods. Nursing care like bathing, bed making, bed sore prevention, catheter diaper care, oral medication administration, nebulization. Feeding with rice tube, temperature charting. It's a very simple thing for some, but it may be very difficult for the unknown person. And hand wash techniques. Prevention of fall and injury. Giving insulin injection is really a difficult task which we have learned over the experience and keeping the record of this blood sugar monitoring. Drug therapy, normal rehabilitation and physiotherapy, which can be learned through a physiotherapist, can be executed at their own home level. And little bit knowledge about the biomedical waste disposal. These are the few actual photographs of these training programs. Changing a bed sheet under a patient who is unable to move from the bed is a difficult task for us, but it is very easy for a nursing person because they have a technique to rotating the patient and changing the bed sheet. Teaching that technique make them life, make their life and the patient's life comfortable. Rise tube, catheter, these are the patients attendant who are taking training. Like I have kept one example in diabetes mellitus, we teach these following things. I will just skip fast. Why to monitor sugar, how will you manage the insulin, what is the test strip, what is the equipment, how will you record, how will you take this sample, how will you make a logbook and show to your doctor, what is the insulin syringe, how to clean the vial of the syringe, wash hands, give the injections. This is all the components of this training programs. Thank you.
Care center is functioning. So some important things that I noted down that was so wonderful, in addition to the normal service that you are giving, some interesting things you are doing. One is daycare center, because many times it is very difficult when it's all said and done, we still have the youngsters, they will be in their profession. So the elderly will be alone, left alone at home. So it is really nice that they have a good daycare center, that you are providing services there. And another good thing was talk with the expert program, their queries clarified, because that is another important issue. They have so much of queries, and so they do not know where to go to. So this is another important aspect that you're taking care of. And in addition to that, yoga and meditation, which is also a prime focus. And now we see with this government, Prime Minister is promoting yoga and meditation, which is very healthy for everyone, including the geriatric. And of course, research you are doing. And another very nice program is the cost-effective long-term care. Yes. Because ultimately, the family members are the ones who are always there for them. And so if we can train them, they are the best ones to take care. And so the various aspects of training that you are doing there. So one is personal hygiene, which is very naturally an inherent part of every program. And you are also focusing on the biomedical waste. That is so important to the society also, because many times we see that it is disposed in the normal family waste, but that is an important aspect you are training them on. And fall and injury, of course, a very important aspect in geriatric care, and how to give insulin. So that also has to, because every day nobody can come, no special person, technician can come and give. So the family people should learn that. So it is a very nice center. In fact, listening to yours, I feel like visiting that center and seeing, actually, maybe sometime we will.
Please give him a big hand.
It is wonderful. Thank you so much.
We open the session to the participants. Yes, sir, please, number one, number two. So, what's your, there's a mic here. What's your name, sir? Please introduce yourself and from where are you?
Hello. I'm Dr. Amit Dias from Goa, and I work in the area of geriatrics as well over there, and I'm working in the Department of Community Medicine. Very happy with the fact that all aspects of geriatric care was covered up. Sometimes we are afraid of, I'm the coordinator of the 1066 Dementia Research Group for India, and I work in that area quite a bit. We also wrote the Dementia India report, and I'm part of the COPE. I'm happy that Sir mentioned about the COPE project was started by us in Goa, now is the ICOPE initiative of the WHO. Comment is that we need to start this fast, because there are some states like Goa, like Kerala, which is facing a high proportion of older people. So I think we should, instead of just waiting for 2020, start that earlier on in states like us. And then we have, what we need is models that work, like your center, sir, which is, we've seen how it works. We don't have to start from scratch or reinvent the wheel. We can just replicate those models, and they're very easy to do. My also submission is that sometimes we're afraid of doing activities for people with dementia. Around 4 million people in India have this problem. But the work that we did with community health workers makes a huge difference for the caregivers and the training program in the community and improves the quality of life. So a lot can be done with very simple, cost-effective measures. And we have everything in paper. We need to put that in place.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. Goa has been a model, which has already been mentioned. And we need to take a message from there. If you would like to add anything to that.
Dementia is a big problem. We are also facing it. But we are fortunately that we are having psychiatrists and psychologists with us, as we have developed a specialty clinic there. So we call to the specialty psychiatrist, and the psychologist is with us. So we are having some dementia care programs over there. But still, it's we are finding
Please
it difficult
switch off
to
the mobiles.
We are finding it difficult to achieve the goals. It's really a good area and needs real need.
Thank you, ma'am. Your question, and please introduce yourself. There's a mic there.
Hello, everybody.
And very short. We need to take three questions more. After that, you and then.
I'm Dr. Huma Khan. I'm working as an assistant professor in SRMS Institute of Medical Sciences, Bareilly, UP. And I'm working as an assistant professor in Department of Community Medicine. And while working in the fields, and I have visited lots of villages because our institute runs a mobile hospital, and I'm taking care of that. So I got a chance to visit most of the villages in the four districts of our division. And what is the problem I have noticed with the elderly, that the facilities are there in the hospitals and medical colleges, but they have nobody to accompany them, and neither there are, I'm not aware whether there are any free transportation services, or have they been underlined so effectively as we do for the antenatal or other cases.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Indrajit, will you like to respond to her? And Dr. Because this is a common problem. She said that there's no transportation.
Sir,
you
come
here.
That's okay. No problem. Ma'am, there are two components in this. One is to take care of such people. There is a component in the program by the home visits. Program is under development, there is no doubt in it. But the component is there. There is a component of home-based, and now we'll see very shortly under the Ayushman world, one of the component is geriatric care, and that is specifically to provide the care to the people who cannot come to the community. So that will be taken care of over here. The second component is also there, that in some of the states they have started 108 services. There is a need for such people. They can be transported from their home to the facility and facility to pay. The program is there, but it may not be available everywhere where it is, but it will take time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for this wonderful input. Yes. Sir, your question?
Sir, we are here carrying the geriatric service. Government itself neglected the geriatric service. Suppose I am giving some example. I am running from Bardhaman and Kolkata and back to the government. It is 230 kilometers every day, and I am seeing what is seen. In local train, EMU 10, 12 coach, only 7 seats are for geriatric purposes who are more than 65 years of age. One. I am sometimes conference here and there. There is no reservation for geriatric population. Only this service, only the lower berth, if we get the service. Even in bus, in government bus, only 48 seats, of which only 2 for geriatrics. Now, this is the part of that. Not part of who will provide the geriatric service, but our service. I am Dr. Tusharkanti Mondol, community medicine associate professor, SSKM Hospital, Kolkata. So, who will give the service in our hospital? There is no geriatric clinics in our West Bengal. I was in the OPD service by the request.
If I get your question, doctor, who will be the service provider? Dr. Indrajit, please answer.
Thank you. In every state, the system is different. The question is very clear. There is a provision for the LDPP, even in the bus, that is the government service transport, railway, air travel. There is a provision, reservations for the older people. They will get concession in and priority basis, the choice of their ticket, that is there. Now, if I cannot say that everybody will be in a position to get, but there is a provision there. There are 14 other line ministries which are providing A, B, C, D, E, F to the care, something like the income tax rebate. There is a telephone priority. There is police attending to the
houses at home the elderly people. So there are 14 line ministries which are engaged to provide the services to the people. I think that this states where the number of the elderly people, about them, everybody may not get the opportunity, but the opportunity is there that the people are there, they are providing services, the provisions are there. It can be expanded, it can be reduced depending upon the need.
Any preventive service, any order from the MCI or any other college, the preventive medicine faculty can give preventive service to the geriatric population in OPD.
Got it. Under the program, geriatric people, they are getting free of cost all the medical medicines. The example is there, the RGC, I am sitting at the center level, there are madam is sitting over there. The senior citizens, they get all the drugs which are required for their management free of cost. And if they are not available in the center, there is a provision under the program to procure. It again depend upon the state to state. Some people community medicine run, somewhere the medicine people run the program.
Dr. Mohan Doivale from Government Medical College, Aurangabad, Maharashtra. Sir, recently you have started MD Geriatrics Department, and we want to convert it in the regional center. Can you guide me?
Very excellent. I think I was expecting this question. I prepared for this. There are two ways to get the community medicine, geriatric medicine. So one is through the RGC. 20 RGCs are there, and they are supposed to do four things. One, declare the Department of Geriatric Medicine. Number two, create a 30-bedded indoor ward. Number two, get two regular faculty, and 38 you can engage on contractual. Get the affiliation of universities. Nobody can stop you to getting
get
the MC.
Number.
That is number one. Number two, how you get the geriatric? There is no need of getting geriatric. If you get, your aim should be get MD geriatric medicine, and everybody will run behind you. Then you are recognized
short.
Center.
Very
you
short.
Can apply for the grant, 1.2 grant per sheet, you will get the
Yes, I'm Dr. Rai from Darbhanga Medical College. One question to Dr. Indra Prakash, that pan-India, throughout India, there should be one situation, and we have got adolescent clinic everywhere in India, PSC, CSC, and medical colleges. Why not the geriatric clinic? The question is that you are telling that different states has got different levels of care for the geriatrics. The many states do not have at all, and few states have got. If for adolescent, arts clinic, pan-India, throughout the medical colleges and health centers, CSC, PSC, then why not geriatric clinic? It has to happen, and I like that.
The best of my knowledge, sir. Wherever there is a program, there is a district clinic regular, there is a CSE clinic, there is a PSE clinic. So that clears your answer. Under the program, the implementation has to be done by your state people, but slowly. And you will see very shortly, PSE and sub-center, there will be clinic. First will be coming, then the district hospital, very shortly.
Okay, as we come to end of this session, I would like to thank our chairpersons and speakers for conducting such a wonderful session, and the speakers for this interesting session. And before we close, I would request Dr. Sunila Garg to please felicitate our speakers. Dr. Inder Prakash, ma'am, please come on the stage. Dr. Sunila to felicitate Dr. Indra Prakash.